Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thanks to each of you for joining us. Thanks for all you do to keep our armed services running well, and I'm a big fan of the Air Force and appreciate what you do. Late last year, the Air Force began a study into the future needs of test ranges and their infrastructure on those ranges, a key to maintaining readiness and innovation within the Air Force. What would you say, and this is open to all of you, any of you who want to answer it, what do you believe are the most critical needs for Air Force test ranges in order to make sure that those ranges are able to adequately test fifth-generation aircraft and weaponry against the threats that they're likely to be facing in the next few decades?
Yes, sir. So, you know, we dealt this year, as we start to build our 17 budget, we took a brief that you may have seen from our test and evaluation people that outlined the state of our test and evaluation enterprise. And as we know that we're contemplating, as the chairman said, spending, you know, hundreds of billions of dollars on the Air Force here over the next 20 years in a modernization effort, that we need to make sure we have the test and evaluation enterprise that will support testing those things and making sure that they work. So we spent a multi-year project kind of bringing together exactly what needs to be done to accomplish that. And the kinds of things we're talking about are simulated threat emitters, so that you can go out and fly against a particular SAM system and see, you know, if it works or not. The test stands, where you can put aircraft on a test stand and look at different wavelengths of energy against them, so see whether they're detectable or not by different radars, and to test those capabilities that we're bringing forward. And then there's also some S&T issues of things like wind tunnels and test facilities and those areas. We've put a plan together. We think we have a plan to start going toward to pay for it. As we start talking about our test and evaluation enterprise, because of those programs that we're going to test and evaluate, it gets difficult to talk about in an open session. But we can come back and provide you some more information.
Great. And I would say many of us are keenly aware, as we move to this next generation of whatever you call it, A2AD, fifth generation air superiority, we need the testing and then the accompanying modeling and sim, because of the scales we're going to be doing over, to make this realistic so that those of us can feel confident we really understand these systems. Because you really look at the scales that we're now involved, and we have multiple platforms, right? The future, one of the things that the F-35 brings, F-22, is the fact, you know, that four-ship and all that, and the fusion. We would love to be able to test that robustly over large areas, at least somewhat, to validate it against, as General Holmes said, realistic emitters, realistic threats. We don't want to be testing against 2-foot-tall adversaries, potentially. We need to test against modern stuff. And it's a challenge. And just as somebody who comes out of testing in my heritage, is that it's increasingly harder to test things because our ranges get more encroached on, our restrictions become closer. But we have to do it. There's no substitute for a test. As we say, all models are wrong, some are useful. You have to test.
No, that's right. No, thank you for that insight, and I hope you know how much support there is in Utah for the great work that you do on the Utah Test and Training Range. It's one of the great assets that we have is the Utah Test and Training Range, given the sheer expanse of land that we've got there, a lot of uninterrupted land that can help with the very things you're describing. Dr. LaPlante, the Air Force is migrating the logistics function under your office in an attempt to create better efficiencies and cost benefits between acquisition programs and the sustainment and lifecycle processes. Can you give us an update on this process and tell us about, you know, what provisions exist within the structure to ensure that the logistics deputy has an opportunity to adequately influence the process of acquisition so that sustainment considerations are built into the weapon systems from the beginning?
So this has actually been really exciting. It's March now. We did it on October 1st. And what we did, just for the rest for the chairman and for the rest of the committee, we brought in the headquarters of the Air Force, the logistics policy and experts into the acquisition. Now, the risk was, for people who really know how good the Air Force does logistics and how wonderful our depots are, hey, you acquisition people, you better not screw up what's going really, really well. But on the other hand, if you can pull this thing off and you can get acquisition experts in at the beginning of these programs, as I said earlier, 70% is in the cost, it could be a pretty wonderful thing. It's a pretty wonderful thing. I ran into my two-star equivalent who leads that part of my organization just last week, Dan Fry. I said, Dan, how's it going? Because remember, that organization was picked up down the hallway and moved into mine. He goes, we are so busy. We are overwhelmed. I said, was it more than you used to be? Yeah, why? What's going on? All the acquisition people are bringing us into all their meetings at the beginning of the acquisition process. It's like it's changed the culture. So I think it's really, really exciting.
Exactly what you wanted to hear, right?
That's exactly, yes, yes. I mean, all the signs are really good. And I have to give a shout out to General Bruce Litchfield at the Air Force Sustainment Center. You see it at Ogden, we're seeing it at Tinker, we see it at Warner Robins. Just remarkable stuff. And so, hey, you know, the fact that we can cozy up and bring some of that magic together with acquisition, I mean, I think it's really awesome. So it's all so far so good.
Yeah, I'm pleased to hear it. As you know, a lot of us were nervous. Everyone was nervous when it happened, but it seems to be good so far. And Mr. Chairman, if I can ask one more short question, if I promise to make it short. There was an article published on military.com last week, indicating that the F-35 won't be able to fire the small diameter bomb 2, the close air support weapon, until 2022. Can you tell us about what other close air support capabilities the F-35 will be capable of prior to that 2022 time horizon?
Yes, sir. So when we talk about having an initial CAS capability, it means that the airplane, when it starts that IOC, it'll have the ability to use GBU-12 or a laser-guided weapon. It'll have the ability to use a JDAM, the drop-on coordinates, and it'll have the radios and the messaging required to be able to operate with a JTAC to take both digital CAS messages that come through without words that pass coordinates and instructions, or it'll have the right radios to talk to the guys on the ground to do that. Later on, in the models that we get to by FOC, we'll integrate SDB. As you said, and I saw the article. The article I saw said it won't fit in the Marine Bay. I'm not sure if that carries over to us or not. We'll have to get back to you. But it'll start out with that initial capability, and then it will add larger JDAM, the 2,000-pound JDAM, the ability to carry GBU-12s outside of the wing, and the ability to carry SDB inside and maintain its stealthiness while it does it.
Great. Thank you.
Just one addition, sir. In between IOC and FOC, the F-35 will gain the capacity to shoot the 25-millimeter gun, which will also enhance its capability in the CAS environment.
Great. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Senator Manchin.